Yes, hello students. So in continuation of the previous video, in this video we are going to learn about plasma membrane and its function. So as you know, we talked about protoplasm. So protoplasm is the fluid part of cell which include nucleus and cytoplasm, and to separate one cell from another cell, to separate cytoplasm of one cell to another cell, there is a universal membrane present. That membrane separate one cell from another cell, as well as that separate the cell from the environment, that make the outer lining of the cell. Okay, cell membrane or plasma membrane is present in all type of cell. It may be plant cell, animal cell, or it may be cell of bacteria or any other. So we can say cell membrane is a common membrane present in all type of cell. Like cell wall may present in plant cell, fungal cell, bacterial cell, but it is absent in animal cell. But when we talk about cell membrane, it is the outer lining or boundary of all type of cells. So let's discuss about the organization, its chemical components and basic functions of the plasma membrane or cell membrane. Please keep in mind, plasma membrane term we use for all kind of membrane which make the boundary of cell, which is present as the lining of cell, or the membranes which make inner compartments of the cell. Like the membrane present in surrounding of nucleus is called nuclear membrane, that is also a plasma membrane. Membrane of different cell parts like mitochondria, chloroplast, all these together we can use word plasma membrane. But when it make the lining of cell, then we use word cell membrane. Like it make lining of mitochondria, mitochondrial membrane. If it is as the lining of nucleus, then nuclear membrane. In general we say plasma membrane. Okay, and specifically we say cell membrane, nuclear membrane, mitochondrial membrane, and so on. Okay, so let's talk about plasma membrane. It has got other names also. As I mentioned, when it make the outer boundary of cell, then it is called cell membrane. This is also known as the plasma lemma. Okay, now if we look into a cell, okay, like there is a one of the very important cell we are familiar with. This is a cell of amoeba. So this we consider as the cell membrane, right? So this cell membrane separates this cell from its environment. Okay, it make a separation between the environment and the cell in case of unicellular organism, and if it is a multicellular organism, then also cell membrane separate from one cell to another cell. That also help in communication with other cell, exchange of substances with other cell, that we will discuss in detail. So first of all, if you look into the chemical composition, so chemical composition of the cell membrane. When we talk about chemical composition of the cell membrane, please remember all the membranes have same chemical components. All type of cell have same chemical components. No need to remember them separately, like cell wall, implant is made up of cellulose, in other cell it is made up of some other chemical. But in case of cell membrane, in case of plasma membrane, chemical composition remain universal in aspect of all the cells. So chemically, plasma membrane is made up of two very important components, that is phospholipids and another very important component is protein. So these are the two main chemical components of the cell membrane. Beside this, some amount of sugar is also present. These sugar are polysaccharides. polysaccharide. But please, at least these two components, which are the main component of the plasma membrane, we have to learn and remember. And this is these are the chemical which are commonly present in all kind of membrane, phospholipids and protein. Lipids, all of you know, the lipid containing phosphate is called phospholipid. So quickly now look into the structure of phospholipids. In plasma membrane, there is presence of, always remember, bilayer of phospholipid. Bilayer of phospholipids. Okay, so first of all, we should quickly look into the structure of a phospholipid molecule. If we look into the phospholipid molecule, we will not go into much detail, but still we have to understand. Phospholipid molecule have two parts. Okay, this part is called head and this part is called tail. Okay, this particular part, head, always remember, is hydrophilic and tail is hydrophobic. This is having polarity, hydrophilic. Hydrophilic means this part is water loving, and another part, this is tail, is hydrophobic, means this part is water repelling. Okay, so when we say phospholipid, this is the one molecule. These molecules are arranged in two layers. So the part which is water loving will remain outside. This will be in direct contact with the environment, as well as this will be their direct contact with the cytoplasm, because in cytoplasm water is present and in the surrounding of cell water is present. So head part will be always toward, their polarity will be always toward the cytoplasm or toward the environment. And this part, which is called tail part is hydrophobic, that is water repelling. So this part will always remain inside when we talk about bilayer. So if we say one more phospholipid molecule, if we draw, okay, so always keep in mind this will be the polarity. This is the outer part, inside if we say this is cytoplasm. The tail will always be inward in case of, this is representation of the bilayer. So this is the arrangement of phospholipids in a bilayer. Okay, then we talk about the proteins. Protein molecules are larger, these are the macromolecules. These are present in between the layer of phospholipids. So they are having three dimensional shape. So proteins appear like this. These are the proteins. These proteins, protein molecules are large molecules, and these molecules may be completely embedded inside the plasma membrane or they may be surfacial. So let's quickly draw the simple diagram of plasma membrane to understand its structure, right? So here we have, this is the first layer we are going to show here. This is the layer of phospholipid molecules. They are arranged like this, and most accepted and common method to explain the structure of plasma membrane, the model which explain it, its structure, is called fluid mosaic model. And this fluid mosaic model was given by the scientist Singer and Nicholson, right? So we will write the name of scientist also. So this is how these two layers of lipids are, phospholipids are arranged, and in between there is presence of integrated proteins. Right, so this is protein. Again, so this is very interesting structure. This appear like how the, when we put some drop of oil on the water surface, they all of you know that make a lipid layer on it. Similarly, here if we say this, here what is present? Cytoplasm is present. Okay, outside there is environment. So these layers are arranged like this. There may be some protein molecules. These protein molecules may be surfacial also, means these are the protein which we use word exterior proteins. Okay, so we can continue like this. So these are called phospholipid bilayer. Here we have proteins. This is the exterior internal integrated protein. This is integral protein. This is the interior protein. This is surfacial protein. In simple word, we can say this is surfacial. Okay, protein. So protein may be completely embedded inside or may be surfacial, but sometimes we see there is presence of a long chain of polysaccharide or sugar molecule also. Okay, so this is, we can label as the presence of sugar, or there may be, we can write polysaccharide chain. Okay, so this is the organization of, simple organization of plasma membrane, and this organization, this model is called fluid mosaic model. Okay, that is for only your reference, fluid mosaic model. And this model was given by scientist, name of scientist who gave this model or proposed this model. Very simple name you can remember, Singer and Nicholson. Please remember. So this model was proposed by Singer and Nicholson. Besides that, other models are also there, Robertson's model and so on. So, but only one model you can keep in mind. The best explanation about the plasma membrane given by the Singer and Nicholson, and this model is called fluid mosaic model. Why it is called fluid mosaic? Because this membrane is just thin and these are flexible, provide elasticity and that can expand. That's why it is called the fluid mosaic model. Next, let's move to the functions of the plasma membrane. So this kind of arrangement of phospholipids and protein give scope for the growth of cell. Okay, expansion of cell. This kind of model help us to understand the flexibility, okay, in the cell, right? And it can easily expand, quite elastic, right? So this model, fluid mosaic model, explains well all the features of the plasma membrane and related functions. Okay, so let's look into the functions of plasma membrane. Okay, functions. So in general, we all of you know plasma membrane definitely being outer boundary provide safe to cells. Okay, then this only separate one cell from other cells or from environment. Okay, so it means the boundary which separate the cytoplasm from the environment. Then most important, this membrane only regulate the exchange of substances, movement of molecules across from one cell to another cell, from environment to cell. Okay, so please keep in mind, this is regulation of exchange of substances. This is most important. because cell cannot survive as a single entity. Cell have to interact with the environment. Cell have to interact with the other cells. To interact with other cells, something is taken inside and something is sent outside from the cell. So this exchange is regulated by the plasma membrane, right? Then protection. Okay, being outermost boundary, this protect cell membrane protect the cell. Okay, and last point we can write, if we talk about plasma membrane, compartmentation means that make the compartment within the cell. Okay, so different parts, subparts of cell can do different functions. So compartmentation within cell. Okay, so these are some basic functions or significance of the cell cell membrane for the cell, but we will be focusing and we will be going into detail of this particular function, that is how cell regulate the movement of molecules across the cell membrane. So most important, we will look into how the exchange of substances takes place. So there are different ways by which exchange of substances takes place. So we will be covering, we will be discussing about the first way we will discuss, that is the diffusion. It is a very common term. Diffusion is a physical process. This is commonly seen in the environment, commonly seen when we breathe, commonly seen within our body wherever exchange of substances takes place. So diffusion. Okay, so this is a physical process that will help us to understand how the movement of molecules takes place, right? Then we will talk about another method. This is most common in plants and animals, that is the osmosis, and related phenomenon we will discuss. These are the different methods by which movement of molecules takes place across the cell, from one cell to another cell. So let's try to understand what is diffusion, what is osmosis, and how these two physical processes help the cell to take something inside the cell and to remove from the cell. Diffusion is not a biological process. Diffusion is a physical process. Diffusion is most common method of movement of molecules in gases, in the liquid, and in the solid. But when we talk about the movement of molecules, the direction of movement of molecule is movement, direction of the movement of molecules is very important. So when we talk about direction of the movement of molecules, direction of movement of molecule depends on the concentration. It depends on the concentration. Okay, so concentration means number of molecules. Where more number of molecules are present, the energy will be high. More the energy, movement of molecule will be from the higher energy to lower energy, higher number to lower number. So always we have to keep in mind, generally molecules move from the higher concentration to the lower concentration. We can take many examples. If we burn a piece of paper, okay, so when we burn a piece of paper, the molecule released from paper will automatically move from the higher concentration to lower concentration, and we will see that through the air, the molecules of the carbon dioxide or some other chemical released from that piece of paper will diffuse into the room. Similarly, if we take a glass of water and if you put some crystals of sugar or if you add some salt, okay, so what will happen? These molecules will dissolve and these molecules of sugar or salt will diffuse into the in the water. So molecules have tendency to move from higher concentration to the lower concentration, and this movement of molecules from higher concentration to lower concentration is known as diffusion. Okay, so diffusion we can define as movement of molecules, movement of molecules from higher to lower concentration. higher to lower means more number to less number. Where there will be more number of molecule, energy will be high. So that all depends on the kinetic energy and all. So molecules always have tendency to move from the higher concentration to lower concentration. This point you have to keep in mind. That is the diffusion. And diffusion is commonly seen during the... So what is significance of it? Okay. This is seen during exchange of gases. Okay. Through stomata. So all of you know plant carry out exchange of gases through the stomata. Most common example in plant of diffusion is movement of gases. Exchange of gases through the process of diffusion. Now when we talk about osmosis, this is more important. Osmosis, all of us have to remember that osmosis is a specialized diffusion. This first statement we can write, this is specialized diffusion. Okay, what make it specialized diffusion? Remember, in case of osmosis, only water or solvent molecules move. This movement is also from higher to lower concentration. But here difference is only water or solvent molecule move. Now one question arises, what prevent the movement of solute? Why all molecule in general do not move from higher to lower concentration? So please keep in mind, in case of osmosis, movement of molecules takes place through plasma membrane, or that is called semi-permeable membrane. This takes place through the semi-permeable membrane. Okay, so before we define the osmosis, we have to understand what is semi-permeable membrane. Keep in mind, semi-permeable membrane, plasma membrane or cell membrane is semi-permeable membrane. There are many type of synthetic semi-permeable membranes are also present. Here we are going to talk about two type of what. Here we say this is semi-permeable membrane. Semi-permeable, and another word we use for the plasma membrane is selectively permeable, right? So here I am going to explain these two terms, semi-permeable and selectively permeable. Semi-permeable word we use when a membrane allow only the movement of solvent or water, and through the membrane only solvent can pass, solute cannot pass, then we use word the semi-permeable. Only solvent or water molecules move across the membrane, So I am repeating it. Only solvent or water molecules can move across the membrane, then it is known as semi-permeable. So please remember, that is called semi-permeable. Selectively permeable, word itself, this is self-explanatory term. Selectively means certain solute molecules can pass, certain selected solute molecules can pass, all the solute molecule cannot pass, certain type of solute molecule can pass. It means the membrane will allow the movement of certain solute molecules, okay, along with solvent. if a membrane allow certain solute molecule across the membrane, then we use word selectively. This select and then allow the movement. And if there is only solvent can move, this is very important, or water molecule can move. Okay, solvent or water molecule can move, then we say this is semi-permeable membrane. So you remember this word. So in case of osmosis, two conditions are essential. First condition, when we use word osmosis, only solvent move, right? And there must be presence of semi-permeable membrane. Now if we define the process of osmosis, we have to say movement of solvent molecules through the semi-permeable membrane. Definition is same, movement of molecule from higher concentration to lower concentration, but difference is there. We have to add these two words, movement of specifically solvent molecule and this movement through the semi-permeable membrane, then we use word the osmosis. So let's write the definition of osmosis, then we will try to understand by some activities also. Okay, so here you see osmosis can be defined as movement of solvent molecules from higher to lower concentration, higher to lower concentration through semi-permeable membrane. So here, if we compare the definition of diffusion with the definition of osmosis, you will find these two new terms, solvent and semi-permeable membrane. If we forget to write these two words, this definition will be definition of diffusion. So two things always keep in mind, there is movement of solvent only solvent move, and whenever the solvent move through the semi-permeable membrane or move across the semi-permeable membrane, we use the term osmosis. Okay, now if we have a vessel like this, in this vessel if we fill the water, okay, and if we put some crystals of color or salt or sugar, what will happen in general, these will dissolve and they will diffuse into the complete vessel, and this is diffusion because there is no membrane and there is a free space to move. But if we fix here a semi-permeable membrane, we divide this into part A and part B with help of semi-permeable membrane, so what will happen now, these molecules which are kept in part A, okay, will start diffusion. So they will diffuse within this area A, they will be not able to cross the semi-permeable membrane. Okay, so as I mentioned, in case of osmosis, in presence of semi-permeable membrane, these are solutes, these molecules are solutes, solute cannot move. Water here filled is the solvent. So solute cannot move from higher to lower concentration because of presence of semi-permeable membrane. What can move? Solvent can move. So if you compare the solvent concentration both the side, here we have more solvent concentration. Why here we have more solvent concentration? Because here most of the water molecules are used to make the salt solution or sugar solution. Solute we can take it as the salt. Okay. So if you compare the concentration or number of water molecules inside A and B, B side always have, in this case, have more water molecule. So we know that in case of osmosis, solvent molecules move from the higher concentration to lower concentration, and we will see that these water molecules, okay, or solvent molecules will move from side B to side A, and after some time we will see the water level inside A will start increasing, right? So this is how we can understand osmosis takes place. Similarly, one more quickly we can take example. If we take a petri dish, in petri dish if we fill the water, water is a solvent, and inside this if we put some resins, okay, dry grapes if we put, they should be intact. So you will see that inside and outside, inside the resin and in surrounding of resin, if you compare the solvent, okay, more solvent is present in the petri dish. So this solvent will start moving inside. Only solvent will move, and after some time we will see these resins will swell up. These resins will swell up, and this process is osmosis. But if you test this water after some time, this water will have the normal test. Why? Because solute is not moving out. The sugar present in the resin will not come out. Only water can move inside. So this process, overall, this process is called the osmosis. This is of two type: exosmosis and endosmosis. When solvent move from surrounding to cell, that is called endosmosis. When the solvent move out, that is called the exosmosis. So related phenomenon we will cover in the next video.